And it's not about trends, it's about craftsmanship.
Poetry. Provocation. A silk damask dress with floral embroideries. Spiked leather choker and breastplate spins on one of the mannequins lit from within.
I haven't used models this season because I wanted the work to speak for itself. I didn't want so much for people to say, oh, look at Giselle, what she's looking like now, or whoever. You know, I wanted people to focus on the detail of the clothes. I wanted the collection to be kind of surreal. It just evokes that feeling of every outfit out there on its own, but no outfit is linked. So everything is so individual, nothing looks the same. Exploring techniques, making them more modern and less old-fashioned, really. So like taking it back, taking it away from sort of like that cliché haute couture and trying to bring it to the millennium. And pushing techniques, pushing the ateliers, the embroidery ateliers to do new things instead of the same things. Things they would usually say, no way, you can't do, and I force them to do it, and then they feel, oh, you know.
Touch me, dear.
Just the emotion, you know, that's what I want you to feel. It should have people in tears.
George Lucas of high fashion this season, it's so moving.
From Alexander McQueen's lyrical show with no models, Andre tracks down the young lady Vogue has called the last of the supermodels, Naomi Campbell.
Do you still, after all these years, in this world of high fashion and haute couture of Paris, is it still exciting to come to Paris and work?
It is exciting because Paris is, it's just, couture is just so special. Everything's made on you. It's like a fantasy. It's like, there's only one dress, you know. It's very special. And everyone puts so much work and effort into it. And I still get nervous when I do the shows.
You get nervous still after all these years?
Yeah. Still get nervous. 14 years.
14 years modeling and you're still nervous?
Yeah.
But you never show it. How do you keep your confidence hidden on the runway, though? What do you think about when you're modeling?
Posture, just showing what I'm wearing correctly and not falling.
What do you do when you're not on the runway, when you're not going to a booking, when you're not going to fitting? What do you do in your apartment? Do you sleep most of the days, read?
No, I go dentist, gaudy things, dentist, doctor, massage, body scrub, manicure, and pedicure, all the things I would love to do.
That you don't have time to do. You don't have time to do. Suddenly one day, if you don't feel yourself doing this, what do you think you want to do?
I definitely want to keep working with the charities that I'm working with.
With Nelson Mandela. Talk about that. Tell us about Nelson Mandela.
For me, he's like the ultimate human being who I adore and admire and respect. He's someone that's, I think, a role model to everybody in the world. And I'm really flattered to be working with him and to have met him. I can't believe he remembers everybody's name, which is incredible.
Great. Young teenage girls, when they see you and other models like you, who, you know, have done it for 14 years, and how do you feel when you give so much inspiration to a young girl who sees you coming down the runway on TV? What advice would you give her about becoming a model?
You have to love fashion. I do love fashion. I love wearing clothes. I love the quality of the clothes. I love the material notes and the fabrics. It's very competitive. It's very, it's a lot of traveling. It's, you know, it's hard.
It's hard.
It is hard. It's a business. It's not as glamorous as everyone thinks.
When do you see yourself getting married? And would you have a couture dress made in Paris?
I don't think that I'll be the kind of woman to plan my wedding. I think I'll get married like wherever I want and wear whatever I want. And it's so difficult because I love so many designers. I don't want to plan my wedding. I think it wouldn't work for me.
Okay.
If I'm getting married.
Now to the Musée du Louvre, where the legendary Roman designer Valentino has popped a cork on the year 2000.
Women are mad for Valentino's clothes, mad for his little nothing black dresses. I mean, the drama of it all, the elegant drama.
I make this collection thinking maybe it was the last collection of the at this century. And I want to make something young, modern, very couture in the meantime, extremely luxurious for the evening.
Prices are never discussed at couture, but here's a $50,000 crocodile coat with a sable collar. Venture capitalist figures shearling with an overlay of lace and capri pants. Not sure about those purple lips, Isabella.
I'm still getting over the $50,000 for the coat.
And here, the perfect update of the little Jackie O black dress that Valentino became famous for. Sleek, sophisticated, sexy, sensual. And Valentino's clothes are sewn as if the seams were made of air.
These little dresses, when you see them, you want to wear them right away.
And Naomi wearing one of the trends of the season, beautiful long evening gown with a full-blown evening coat in taffeta, just to catch the air. And again, those seams are as if they've been sewn on air. Look at those earrings on Maggie Reiser. Would you wear those, Isabella?
They look beautiful. They look like inspired to JoJo Keefe, those bigger flowers that she did.
And I saw Joan Collins, and when that came down, this beautiful black satin ball gown strapless, she turned and she looked and she took a note. Surely this is her dress. Here we are, one of the Valentino signatures, red chiffon, which closes the show, worked to its finest inch of nanosecond of perfection. There's Joan Collins whispering about that dress.
After midnight when you're in bed, do you dream your dresses or do you just close your mind? Do you dream about clothes?
No, Andre, I think I'm the only designer in the world that when I finish my day, if somebody speaks about clothes, I kill.
For a look at how Paris haute couture makes its way to stars around the world, InStyle magazine tracks the trail from runway to red carpet.
Few people will ever have a front row seat at a Paris couture show. Yet millions can see the designs of such illustrious houses as Chanel, Dior, Valentino, Versace, and others on some of Hollywood's most celebrated actresses. Nearly half a century ago, in 1953, Hubert de Givenchy met Audrey Hepburn, and the result was the longest-running fashion collaboration in Hollywood's history. He designed the memorable clothes she wore in her films Sabrina, Breakfast at Tiffany's, Funny Face, and others. He even made the wedding dress for her marriage to Dr. Andrea Dotti. Such partnerships still do exist. Last year, Emmanuel Ungaro designed 20 original ensembles for Sharon Stone to wear in her starring role in the Albert Brooks film, The Muse.
Told you.
Today, couture gowns are more often seen on the red carpet. We've seen haute couture treasures worn by celebrities such as Nicole Kidman in Dior, Uma Thurman in Chanel, Versace dresses worn by Elizabeth Hurley, Courtney Love, and Catherine Zeta-Jones. Celine Dion in Dior by John Galliano, Diana Ross in Terry Mugler, and Madonna in Balenciaga. Actresses also don couture fashions for their most important day, their wedding, as Kate Winslet did wearing a dress designed by Alexander McQueen for Givenchy.
Celebrities love wearing these clothes because they cost $250,000. Where else do you get that kind of extravagance? And designers love to see celebrities in these clothes because an audience of 2 billion people get to see what you do. Who could ask for better than that?
The trend for wearing couture hasn't slowed down. Perhaps it's the return of glamour, the revival of color, or the rise of decoration that has spurred the fancy. But one thing is certain, the first inspiration for these couture creations often begins in the rarefied air of a Paris atelier.
From the neoclassic Paris stock market, we go to Emmanuel Ungaro. The designer, known for his signature mixes of color and fabric, calls this collection Byzantine Punk.
I don't know what punk he's dressing. All his favorite clients are oil-rich Texans. Blondes, look
at this. It's more Byzantine than punk.
Well, the blondes that I know aren't punks from Texas who wear his clothes.
Do you know that for that shawl, it was 150 hours of work by different artisans?
And it's going to take $150,000 to dress here at this house. But so what? Emmanuel Ungaro, a master of cut and sensuality. Clothes for you to make drop-dead entrances in.
In a modest rooftop, secret weapon for Paris haute couture, Lesage Embroiders. The family-owned Lesage has worked with couture houses to create breathtaking embroidery season after season for more than a century.
This season, the concept was that to make a dress inspired from an old document, which was made with ribbons. On these dresses, we will have about 850 or 900 hours.
900 hours between how many people are working on it?
Four, five, six. To
six most, women working on one dress.
Let's move to this table. What is this for? What house is this embroidery for?
This is for Saint Laurent.
It looks very Matisse.
Well, it's inspired from the Matisse Russian blouse.
From Lesage's workrooms and the hands, here it is on the runway, the final finished beauty of an embellishment in satin and hand embroidery by Mr. Lesage for Yves Saint Laurent.
Now, Christian Dior at Versailles.
Versailles has always been a fantasy.
Keep imagining people from, centuries going through this hall, processions and everything. It's spectacular.
Why John Gilliam?
Probably of all the shows that I've ever seen just televised, this is the most fascinating one because they're really works of art. And it always seems very theatrical.
I rather thought some people might think we were going to produce some kind of costume drama, but it wasn't.
The makeup is very interesting.
Pat McGrath did the makeup.
But then the romance and for my ladies, there's a very twinkly, feminine light, inspired by Persian miniatures and the paintings of Gainsborough.
Galliano is often inspired by paintings.
The important thing about these clothes is that they're opulent, beautiful evening clothes, and eventually they will be translated by him into wonderful evening wear in his ready-to-wear. But here the customer goes here for drop-dead entrance-making clothes. Crocodile, once again, the theme of the season. And here we are with the hunting thing with fur hats. But the important thing here is that in Europe, these things are considered elements to create a whole picture of romanticism.
Take it away.
And this dress would be translated by a client into chiffon as opposed to leather.
And that's how they will make their way into ready-to-wear.
And you'll finally see it filtering down. But the drama of Mr. Galliano from the makeup. Look at that makeup. And here we are. He saw The Matrix, and he went into this mode of, hand-stenciled zebra makeup by Pat McGrath on Common Cast.
And they walk on water on stilettos.
And they walk on water on stilettos, and Mr. Galliano...
Ah, now, you tell me, how do you make an entrance with that parachute?
Well,
how does it trickle down to ready-to-wear?
Mr. Galliano would want you to wear that to lunch, dear. Extraordinary Carmen Cass went up and down the longest runway in Paris and kept the air in her chute. Galliano, the renegade maverick, the rebel of haute couture. Wonderful, extraordinary theatrical ideas coming from the mind of one of the greatest visionary designers of the century.
Coming up next, the high fashion power of Karl Lagerfeld at Chanel and Dutch duo Victor and Ralph push the limits of performance, fashion, and art.
Now into the eye of a storm of creativity and style, for someone who needs no introduction, Karl Lagerfeld at Chanel.
Describe this photo of this beautiful coat from the collection. This is the first coat in the collection.
What we call the high court Chanel coat, because it has a proportion of a typical Chanel coat of her high days. This is really couture in a way it should be. I think it looks modern, but in the same time, it has all the refined craftsmanship what made the French couture famous.
Karl's collection is the essence of the science of dressmaking and modernity. The essence of what women want, clothes to wear.
Inspiration is about Sex Pistols, punk, but in a soft way. It's not in a destroyed way. It has to look beautiful, it's haute couture.
Notice this extraordinary thing. Isabella, it has its own audio inner elegance.
That's right, you can hear it.
I mean, horrible, but I had the idea in my bathtub.
In the bathtub? So most ideas in your bathtub.
It's very strange, yes.
Especially in the bathtub in the morning is where the collection comes
from. Exactly.
Women just dream of having a Chanel dress. After all, Coco Chanel was the great, great designer of French fashion. She invented couture literally on her own. This one has beauty. One of the most beautiful dresses in the whole couture.
It's a game of chiffon stripes with an abstract geometric pattern. It is only by the movement, the way they are fixed on the body and the way she moves, that it gives the shape, the play, the laminated, weightless effect.
Brilliant, refined, directional, extraordinary. Karl Lagerfeld for Chanel.
A breakthrough collection from young Dutch duo Victor and Rolf.
This is the couture of tomorrow, the couture of 2005. Two Dutch designers who look like Calvinist professors or ministers, ministering to Maggie Reiser. Layer upon layer of beautiful ideas, conceptual brilliance, all in Swarovski crystals, as elaborate as any couture dress, as refined as any couture dress. This is total, total brilliance. They have no clients, and it doesn't matter. One day there will be clients. But it's about modifying everything to one individual. And these clothes can be modified to a client. There's some sort of romanticism here based on some Russian babushka doll. But the layer upon layer of color, excitement, and execution of tailoring and dressmaking. The crowd is going mad. The crowd is in an uproar. They bring the house down. This is couture, future avant-garde, but this is not a mess. Here we go, the final layer. Maggie Reiser ends up looking like the enfant of Prague or an angel. I'd wear this.
You would? What would you wear that?
I'd wear it on Christmas morning. You always need clothes for Christmas Day.
Here is fashion critic from the New York Times, Kathy Horn.
What's been your favorite moment this week?
Oh, well, that's easy. Victor and Ralph.
Why?
Because it was so charming that you came here with these two guys who on a, you know, apparently for something like $60,000 put this wonderful show that was charming. It was about couture. It was great idea, purely from the imagination. And people were spellbound by it and mesmerized by it.
Right.
And I think it just sort of shows that, you know, you bring in young people, they have a wonderful idea, they can carry it forward.
Up next, a study in contrast, fashion theater from Christian Lacroix, and a bevy of bombshells by Terry Mugler when we return to Paris.
British comedy Absolutely Fabulous said it best. Is Lacroix, sweetie?
Well, I think that my style is based on different individuality. My way of designing is proposing girls, women, a way of being themselves. Above all, I really believe in exchanging cultures. Old culture mixed with all the technologies of nowadays. I'm still a lover of colors, and especially now that colors and patterns and prints are back again. Everything is shorter and shorter. And this is hand-painted with sequins. We'll have a lot of sequin black and white.
Andre, are the couturiers afraid of the reviews, and are they emotional the day they do present their collection?
I think they're as emotionally disturbed as some child thinking about the end of the world, the coming of Armageddon. This is Lacroix's new departure into a more graphic, modern art approach to his collage effect of evening wear.
We may be concentrating on some of our designers this season, but the great thing about fashion, and especially high fashion, is that it's constantly changing. New designers breathe life into every season, while established designers continually reinvent themselves. And of the more than a dozen shows held every season in Paris, some of the quietest couturiers are the ones who actually rack up the sales. Supervising every couture season for more than 150 years is French fashion governing body, the Chambre Syndicale. The Chambre decide who is and who isn't a couturier, but lately they relaxed their rigid rules, allowing new energy into haute couture. Before, the haute couture was a closed world, now it opened up, if not to wear the clothes, to admire it like a performing art, to admire it like a visual art. Next, the singular style of Terry Mugler.
What it interests me is to see beautiful human beings, whatever the fashion is. It's not about fashion, it's about style.
Terry Mugler's soul is anchored in Hollywood, the world of Adrian Travis Banton, and the black and white films of his heroine, Marlene Dietrich. This collection has turned away from the camp-a-rama, glamorama, grade B movies that he used to be inspired by, to true couture workmanship. Notice this extraordinary embroidery and these glittering clothes. You'll even sparkle more than the chandeliers you dance under if you wear these clothes. Latex with water bubble prints, a latex rubber dress, a condom dress, this most beautiful green velvet evening coat. This is not a joke. This is serious couture. And Terry has serious cuts. He's always been a master tailor. And what makes it so refined is velvet and latex. Here we are with his ruby red girl. She's like a jewel. She's like a Catwoman. Julie Newmar walked for him once on the runway. It's a Catwoman's dress. And here we have the dream of Diana Ross. I mean, she's a friend of Terry, she's an inspiration, and often she dresses the way this girl, Deborah Smith, this extraordinary African-American, is showing this dress. Diana Ross is probably gonna buy it right off her body. Don't know about the purple lipstick. They're big old purple lipstick this season. And here we have the goddess dress, right out of Kismet. Dietrich and Gold LeMay. Glimmering gold hair, gold makeup, Marcel Waze. Terry's execution of Hollywood dreams taken to a new level of refinement in his own world. I'm very proud to know Terry McGlair. I've always considered him one of the major forces of Paris, a kind of Paris elegance that you can only have if you're born in France and you're French.
Coming up next, a match made in heaven. Haute couture and that special day.
We are now taking you to the House of Chanel and show you what the reality is of couture as it addresses the needs and the life of a woman. Dita Blair, one of the best dressed women in the world, she's deeply dedicated to her work. For over 30 years, she has been involved in scientific research for the Scripps Research Institute. She works for the Harvard AIDS Institute, and she is on the board of the National Institute of Health. I notice you love things like navy blue. I mean, this...
Oh, that dress is beautiful.
Would you, would you do the drop strings? Or would you leave them or would you remove
them? I might leave the, do the drop strings the first year. I might end up cutting them off by year four.
Great.
Her clothes are investments for life. Yves Saint Laurent did his first crocodile jacket in 1960. It's 1999, and here we have its new version. And Dita Blair is thinking of buying this.
And you are going to think of a crocodile jacket?
Have you ever seen one like this?
I've never seen anything as soft.
It's soft. It's beautiful. It's useful. It's practical. You
and
can wear
would you
it.
Do with it. You would wear it.
Morning, night, yeah. And noon.
That's
vermeil.
And have you ever had a fabulous Saint Laurent important dress or suit and gone to an occasion or an event and there's been a friend in the same room, the same thing? Has that ever happened?
I always ask, who is purchasing this? Has this been bought in America? And if it has, I'll change the color. That's the wonderful thing, is you can change the color or you can add something else. No, that's never happened.
Well, this has been an amazing visit, and I thank you for taking us on your afternoon with your decision making.
Well, it's such fun to see these beautiful clothes. You might own, I'll end up maybe buying one. But just looking at them and seeing the workmanship, the craftsmanship, the sheer beauty.
It's great. We really appreciate this inner private view. Thank you so much.
Christian Lacroix feels weddings are the one time when every woman becomes the star of her own fashion theater. Couture collections historically conclude with a bride as a symbol of fantasy pushed to the limits. Here are some of the most stirring bridal gowns from this haute couture season.
Now that's Terry McGlair's bride, and I think it's totally out of Jane Mansfield, The Girl Can't Help It. I mean, the waistline, 16 inches.
Just before the final show of the season, Pierre Balmain at the Louvre, we caught up with one of the most powerful men in fashion, Patrick McCarthy.
What one look are you thinking about putting on a future cover of W?
I think we have to think about the glitziness of it, the fancy, the extravagance of it, the opulence of it. This is the most opulent season in Paris that I can remember in a long time. And it's, we had this, these seasons and seasons of minimalism, and now it just has completely disappeared. And now we have lots of, you know, just beautiful fabrics and beautiful clothes and sumptuousness.
This is the Pierre Balmain Haute Couture Collection. It is designed by Oscar de la Renta, who is the only American couture designer in Paris, and André visited with him before the show.
So, Oscar, what do you, as an American-based designer, think an American couture client wants?
Fantastic clothes. I think that they have sort of a fantastic, extraordinary sense of luxury, what you know, couture is all about, and then a sense of reality, what the clothes should be, what suits their lifestyle, and they come to Paris for that, because that's what Paris has to offer. A woman comes here to find something beyond just beautiful clothes. They want clothes that are excitement. You have to give them that extra thing that makes them really special.
So therefore, a poncho made of sable skins that has been knitted to look like a sweater is something that you would not find at the local feed store that looks like a horse blanket otherwise, well, although it can be treated like a horse blanket, correct?
Well, that's the whole point, but actually, you will not find a horse blanket that is made out of sable. And this is so unbelievably light, you know,
it's like weightless.
A feather. It's
that's
weightless.
That's the new
and
thing of it.
That's what makes it exciting. And then that is knitted. That is really, really casual, but this has this extraordinary sense of wonderful luxury.
I can't name her, but his favorite couture client is ordering 10 outfits from this collection. Every season, it still is exciting. You never get tired. You never say, oh, I want to stop.
You know, this is a business of passion, and you have to really be passionate about what you do, otherwise you cannot do it. There is nothing more exciting than being in your studio, work with your assistant, mm-hmm. with your people, and creating beautiful clothes.
This is the final couture collection of the 20th century, and André puts it all in perspective for us.
Here we are on the Pont Alexandre Trois, the Eiffel Tower behind us. This is an extraordinary week. Sheer indulgences, flights of fantasy. Donatella Versace, Miss Rock and Roll, in your face. Glam, bam, thank you, ma'am. Go for it, Madonna. Valentino, the man who dressed Jackie O at the peak of his craft after four decades. Jean-Paul Gaultier, absolutely dizzying glamour, defines the wit of Paris. Karl Lagerfeld for Chanel, the brilliance of a chiffon dress worked like a Japanese lantern, the essence of couture, the science of couture. Victor and Rolf, the mad duo of fashion, magical, artistic, sophisticated, wild. Monsieur Oscar de la Renta for Balmain, wonderful clothes for clients, sheer and total romanticism. Thierry Mugler, Mr. Hollywood of Paris. You want to be a Marilyn Monroe, Jane Mansfield? Go for it in a Mugler gown. It's been a marvelous week with marvelous moments. Poetry, fantasy, fun. Au revoir, Isabella.
Au revoir, André. Thank you very much to you all. Au revoir, merci from Paris.